is Not Sam Wrestling.
Introducing your host from New York, here is Sam Roberts.
We are blessed now to be joined by the stars of Miz and Maryse, or Miz and Mrs. I got ahead of myself. One of the stars now of Monday Night Raw, the Miz, Mike Mizanin, and Maryse are here. Welcome, guys. How are you?
That might be the worst introduction
How?
We've ever had in our entire lives. Like, that was atrocious. Like, I would have stopped and then redid the whole take because you obviously messed up, but obviously you don't care enough to do something like that.
Well, you just
throw it in and you just say, hey, I'm just going to kind of half do it.
It's not a half do. There's an authenticity to it when I do it like that. You know, there's an authenticity of people knowing, okay, this is the real deal. This is not some like glitzed up Hollywood thing. And also, I'm not the one who half named the show after you guys. Like, that gets complicated. That half of your name is the show. Half, you know,
what are you talking about? Miz and Mrs. is a fantastic name. When we put that name out there,
yeah,
people are like, what a great name. So good.
Is that
so
what the-
good? What a hit show.
I mean,
you know,
look,
not like the Sam Roberts, you know, like, it's great.
Look,
you know, I understand it's very early in the morning. Maybe you just have a cup of tea.
Well, babe, it's not early for him.
Well,
it's like 9:30 for him. Like, it's 6:30 for us. Okay. He's living the life, you know,
you know, have a piece of cake for breakfast and a little cup of tea. And yeah, you'll just, you know, wake up better.
I will. You know, I will. Excuse me for being excited to talk to you guys. That is a hit. I can't say it's not a hit. I mean, clearly it's back for season two. So the show is a fabulous hit. People remember that it's on. So maybe I'm off. But, you know, it's not like I just made up some name off the top of my head. Your names are Miz and Maryse. That's how I got to know you anyway. I'm a WWE fan first.
Mm-hmm.
So
was there a question in there, or are you just making a statement?
Well, that was a statement, but I can go into
usually an interviewer asks questions and like we answer those questions, but obviously you just want to make statements and you know, just do your thing. Go ahead, Sam.
I'm a huge fan of anyone entertaining, and this is pretty entertaining. So
right. Sam woke up this morning, literally got out of bed, uh-huh, went right to his studio and started shooting. Like, that's what he does. That's it.
He
doesn't leave his house.
He
doesn't go to an office.
That happened between you and Sam that, like,
Sam's a jerk. Sam,
I'm a jerk.
One time, Sam, I had an interview, a whole thing at Sirius. Like, the whole, like, I did everything at Sirius. And I was like, wait a second.
I know about that.
Doesn't Sam, like, work in this building?
Right.
And they're like, yeah, Sam works in this building. And I'm like, well, and when am I doing Sam? I can't wait to see him. They go, oh.
All right, can you kids shake hands and wait, just no. like.
He goes, I'm too, Sam is too busy for you today. That is what happened.
That's not what happened.
Ever since then, I will never forgive him.
That's not what happened.
I remember that story because I was there. And I heard about it in the car for 3 hours.
Okay. Well, it's not what happened. I thought we got past that. Apparently, we have not gotten past it. You're both here now. I made the time now to make sure that I did. And by the way, you know, at least I have the studio and everything. I mean, you know, usually we at least get some kind of Zoom interaction, not just a phoner. I mean, you have a media room in your house. I've seen it. I remember there's a whole screen behind you and you switch the screen and everything. And I saw you on Instagram and you're like, we're here in the media room promoting. And then it's like, wow, no, you're not getting the Miz Maryse visual today. This is just a phoner.
You get a phoner. You're welcome.
You get it.
You're lucky you're getting that.
Oh, I guess I am lucky. You know, I will say this. I saw an advanced, I'm telling you, I'm a big deal. I saw an advanced screener of the first episode of the new season of Miz and Mrs.
Whoever gave you that screener is fired. They should not be giving you early screeners. You're not big enough to get an early screener.
All right. Well, I'm not going to mention who gave it to me then to protect them, right, you know, because that's the type of guy I am. But here's what struck me, okay? I was watching and there was all this, the season premiere starts at last year's WrestleMania in New York. And I was watching and there was all this nice, wonderful, beautiful family stuff that we've come to expect from Miz and Mrs. But what was in my head, because I remember that WrestleMania, is I don't understand the balancing act that you two pull off, because literally the same day that you're having all this wonderful, beautiful family stuff, Miz, you had one of the most violent matches in the history of your career. The things that you did that day are things that a family man doesn't do. I mean, at what point in the day do we shut off, okay, birthday parties and here's my family and everybody is having a great time and, you know, go to battle?
Well, I mean, that's what you have to do to be a WWE superstar. You know, it's when I'm home, I'm Mike Mizanin. I'm a dad, you know, I'm dada, if you will. I'm at Monroe and Madison's beck and call. I am their clown. I am their entertainment all day long. And then once I go to WWE, I'm everyone's clown and everyone's form of entertainment, the world's entertainment. But no, like you flip it on. There's a switch that is flipped, and then it turns into the Miz, and you lock in your focus and you try to figure out what is best for not only, you know, what the WWE universe needs, but like what the company needs. And you figure that out, and you have one of the best matches that has been seen at a WrestleMania in a very long time.
There is, and also a great cameo from your dad in that WrestleMania match. So that's where the family
does.
You
understand that now that that cameo has happened, my dad has turned that 15 minutes of fame into like 15 years. Like he is just, it's every Monday night he calls me and goes, Mike, you know, you're doing wrong. And I go, Dad, I've been doing this 15 years. Like, I don't need you to tell me. He goes, obviously you do, because I was in the ring for 5 minutes and I became a meme. And I went viral, and everyone's talking about me. So yeah, you know.
I mean, look.
Now I have to listen to him all the time.
I'll tell you, you know, you took a long time to really hit your peak in the WWE, and you had to go through a lot of hurdles, and you had to go through a lot of naysayers, right? Until you finally became that star on the level that you always thought you were capable of. Your dad got in the ring for 5 seconds, and it's on a T-shirt. That is an accomplishment. That is a pretty.
I mean, you know, people dream of having a WrestleMania moment their entire careers. And some people never get that dream. But my dad literally just not only never had the dream, but made a dream. And he now has it and doesn't. I don't think he understands the level of how important that was and how cool that was for him to get in a WWE ring and do it. He's just like, yeah, of course I did. I'm George Maizanin.
Just a little bit like my mom with Miz and Mrs.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think they understand how hard it is to have a television that's a show that's on a network.
They just think things are given to them.
Yeah, they're like, yeah, you know, great, okay, sure.
Yeah, like USA lucked out because they got your mom.
That's the way she thinks.
Yes. And then she's like, oh, everyone loves me because on Instagram, people are giving me compliments. And I'm like, yes, but these are like 50,000 people that are following you, which, by the way, it doesn't make sense because I have a lot of followers, but I don't always get compliments.
Yeah, exactly. So we always get the negative, and our parents get all the positive, and then they think they're the biggest stars in the world. And whenever your parents think they're the biggest stars in the world, is not a good situation for you.
No. And also, you know, I think about that WrestleMania, and I think about the hell that you went through. And I think about you limping back, you know, to the locker room and going like, oh my God, like, I can't believe I pulled all that off, falling off ladders. You're in the middle of Giant Stadium. You know, you're all over the building, and you get to the back and you look at the internet, and what are people talking about? They're not talking about anything that your body just went through. They're talking about how great your dad was.
They didn't talk about my 20-foot fall off of a scaffolding. Yeah. No. They talk about my dad putting up his stupid dukes, looking like an idiot.
Yeah.
And then Mike's mom backstage being like, oh, I would have went in there and I would have beat him. I would have like defended my Michael.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, Mike right now is hurting in the back.
My mom was jealous that my dad got all that fame. And I was like, guys, like, look, I just had a wrestling match. Like, can you guys support me?
Right. Well, no, they got a taste of it. They got a taste. And you gave it to them. I mean, you're the ones who are like, well, our family should be on a reality show. And then USA Network agreed. And then the world tuned in. And I feel like you guys created,
created some monsters.
Yeah, I remember at WrestleMania, Mike was in the ring, and I was with everyone, the suite upstairs, and Barb wanted to go downstairs, and I said, "You cannot go by the ring." She's like, "I'm going by the ring right now. I'm going," and I'm like, "She cannot. She doesn't understand that, like, she can't just like jump in there, like she." So I was battling with her, my mother-in-law, trying to tell her, no, it's not, we're not in a bar fight here. You're not going to start like punching and kicking people.
Fresh Prince said it the best. Parents just don't understand.
He did. Yeah. That's exactly right. I feel like there should be like a documentary on WWE stage parents, because I, like, Zack Ryder has the same story about his dad jumping into the ring at WrestleMania after he won. Like, he's like, "What are you doing here? Why are you
yeah,
in the ring?"
Yeah, that was
right
a real
now?
Moment. Like, his dad got so excited. Like, I think that's amazing, though. His dad, like, yeah, jumping the barricades to give his son a hug. My dad would never do that. My dad would be like, "Wait a second. Wait, they're not putting the camera on me?"
Yeah.
Like, right. My dad doesn't, like, hug me. My dad doesn't tell me, like, "I love you," or give me any kind of that kind of support.
Well, we kind of see it on Miz and Mrs. a little bit. It's one of my favorite episodes, actually.
Great, thanks. Thanks, babe.
Your dad is trying to hug you, and it's just really awkward.
Yeah, like, anytime my dad tries to show any type of affection, it gets really awkward and weird. And it's become so awkward and weird that we can't do it. Like, it's just, we don't hug. We don't tell each other, like, how we feel. It's just, it's gotten to a point where it's just too weird to do that.
Yeah,
and we do an entire episode on that, because my wife actually was like, we just do an episode on, like, just show you and your dad's dynamic. I go, "Maurice, please, can we not?" Like, I don't want to do this because, like, I don't want, in the end, like, us having to hug. I really don't want that.
Oh, my goodness. You know you're F him, right?
Huh? What do you mean? I hug my daughters every day. I tell them I love them every day.
No, I know. But I was saying, he's your dad still. Like, it's like.
But right, I'm not like him in the form of that.
You know
aspect.
What's funny when I say you're like, "Oh, you remind me of George," and you panic and you're like, "Absolutely not. I'm not like George." And then I hate when he says, "Oh my gosh, you're like Marjo." And that
is. Well, you are like Marjo.
Oh my gosh.
It's
okay,
like
this
a replica.
Interview is done. I have to leave.
I love that you both have the same problem, where a lot of times, you know, you bring your parent, like, you create this world, like, you both, you know, accomplish these things that a lot of people never accomplish. And you get to, you know, to perform on the level that you guys perform on, whether it's in WWE or on reality TV or whatever it is. Like, that's a premise that a lot of people don't get to actually feel what it feels like. So you would think that you bring your parents in, you give them a little taste of it, and they go, "Oh my God, I have a new appreciation for what you guys go through." And instead, in both your cases, they turn around and they go, "This is not that tough. As a matter of fact, we're bigger stars than either one of you two are."
100% that. Isn't that terrible?
That is
terrible.
Amazing explanation.
Yes, and that's exactly right. It's 100% correct.
You should make them watch and listen to this interview.
See?
Yeah, no, it would go in one ear, out the other. And they would just go, "Oh, like, why wasn't I on the interview?"
No, my mom would go, "I don't understand. I don't speak English." I'm like, "What?"
Yeah. Now, see, Ms., like, I start, as we talk about your parents, I start to understand where maybe some of the oversensitivity and hostility comes in. Like, I don't think that all the hostility maybe is directed towards me. I think these are deep parental issues.
No, it's definitely directed towards you. No.
Okay,
yeah,
that one.
It's definitely tough. And you know, it could have all been prevented, but you snubbed me.
You did come in that day.
And I broke in. I said, "Where is Sam Roberts' office? I'm going into his radio show." "Oh, wait, sir. No, you can't do that because he's busy. He didn't have time for you today." And I broke in the door and I said, "Why don't you have time for me?" And you were doing nothing. You were like eating a Snickers bar.
If I remember right, I think we were talking about Tide Pods that day.
100%.
Yes,
the Tide Pods. Oh my
you
God.
You were upset.
You were.
You're upset about that
specifically. Tide Pods were too important that. For me.
So I think one of the reasons this show works, right, is because of not just because you both have extremely photogenic Hollywood parents, but because the chemistry between you guys. And I also see that in WWE. When I think about Miz, the run that you had on SmackDown and going into Raw as Intercontinental Champion and that level, I mean, I feel like you went up several rungs on the ladder pretty quick. And something I think, I don't know if I'm starting trouble here, clicked in when Maryse came back and the act became The Miz.
And you just started a whole...
No, that's actually not starting trouble. Okay. That's actually correct. That's
okay.
Actually absolutely 100% correct. When Maryse came into the back with me,
yes,
when I was with that Intercontinental Championship run,
yes,
like it created something inside. I don't know what it is. It's something about having your wife around the ring. It brings a whole new set of confidence. You know, you have this beautiful woman supporting you, and it gives you this level of confidence that you're untouchable, that you can't be scathed in WWE. And having her around definitely allowed me to feel that.
And also, it's one of those things.
That's 100% correct.
When you want people to boo you, it's when you're alone, everybody can boo you and be like, yeah, everybody hates that guy. But it's infuriating for everybody in the arena to be like, yeah, we all hate him. But then there's Maryse being like, no, he's right. You're all wrong. I think it drives people crazy to that next level. Now there's a family. Now there's children. Now there's all this going on. Maryse, is there any itch in you to at some point
always
take that role back? You want that?
I think there's always. And, you know, the thing about me is that I'll be like, oh, I have kids. I have a family. But also when I start getting excited about something, then that becomes something that my brain gets busy with. And, you know, my husband is Money in the Bank. WrestleMania might be in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you start adding all these elements. Also, the fact that I love WWE. I love everything about it. So, you know, it's kind of been my family for so long. Also, I don't think I'll ever be not back somehow.
Yeah.
In some capacity,
I always come back. Listen, I was back on SmackDown. I just had a baby 5 months. I was 5 months postpartum, and I had a match against Brie Bella on SmackDown. We were the main event. Like, you would have told me that when I was pregnant, I would have started laughing.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And that happened.
Yeah.
So how, you know, so it's really hard to say never. We'll see.
We were, I think it'd be a good thing. Yeah. I think it would be good.
You never say never, but let's face it. I do have the Money in the Bank contract right now. Can cash in anytime, anywhere. Randy Orton, Roman Reigns, whoever has the WWE or Universal Champion at the time. You know, I have that opportunity to get that. And I know that when I'm with my wife, Maryse, I know nothing can stop me. And so you never know.
We're go-getters, you know?
Yeah,
and then
exactly.
I see that opportunity and I'm like, oh, wait a minute here. Uh-huh.
I mean, this isn't the Intercontinental title we're talking about. Granted, it was the most prestigious and honorable title when I had it.
Right.
But if I have the WWE or Universal Championship, I am the poster child of WWE. I am the talk. And if I'm the talk, guess who else is the talk? My missus, Maryse.
And your dad.
Well, actually, you know what? The whole family will probably have to come in.
Yeah.
I think they will. I think you're out now. Okay, so you, your dad, your wife all have performed in WrestleMania matches. So I do feel like there are other members of the family that are going to be itching to get those opportunities.
Oh, please, Sam, don't. I hope they thank God they don't listen to your show.
Why not? I mean,
you know, my parents have no idea how to even use a cell phone. I have to sit there and show them how to use Instagram, how to use Twitter, how to use anything. They can't figure out how to turn you on.
I get a notification that my mom is on Instagram Live. So I go, she doesn't want to use that. So I go and check, and she's basically sitting in the kitchen, just like you see her whole face, and she's talking randomly to, like, I don't even know what she's saying, and she doesn't know she's live. So that's what she does. And I'm like, do you understand, like, what you just did? Like,
and she doesn't.
And she's like, oh, it's okay, it's okay. And then I see all these screen caps of, like, her chin. oh my god.
Yeah, usually, like, you just have to do tech support for your parents and it's just you being annoyed in their house. It's not like 100,000 people watching along on Instagram as well.
Exactly.
So, you know, I mean, you said you didn't want to do the episode about your dad and trying to find some level of affection between the two of you. Whose idea was it to be like, oh, you know, Missionary Mike is a nickname that's been going around. We should definitely bring this to television.
Zach Ryder.
Yeah.
That is a Zach Ryder coined term. We were in a locker room one day. It was like a European tour. Mm-hmm. And Ryder was talking to us about sexual stuff. And I was like, oh my God, really? And he goes, what are you, Missionary Mike? And everyone erupted in the locker room. And now, like, if I call like Xavier Woods, I show up as Missionary Mike on his cell phone. Like, that's how it is in
and
the locker room.
And it's not even, that's not even a popular.
It's not even my position. It's not even our position
of
preference.
No, it's not even. It's not even in the book.
Not even that. Like, and not only that, like, I'll see Big E. Big E's like, Missionary Mike. Like, it's a thing now. And I don't want it to be a thing because I'm not a missionary guy.
And then they look at me and they smile. And I'm like, you guys, like, what the heck?
Yeah.
You bunch of kids.
Isn't that great, though, that even your wife is sitting there going, like, it's not true. And they don't believe her. They'd rather call you. They'd rather.
They want to believe. They're like, they just like the name.
Yeah, don't spoil this for us. It's an alliteration. It's too perfect. But that's the other thing, too. I mean, you go through years of like proving yourself and proving yourself and proving yourself, and it's still after you've proven yourself to a level that most people will never get to prove themselves. You've cemented yourself as a guy who's not only a WWE superstar but has more lasting power than just about anybody, right? I mean, the legacy that you've got, at some point I feel like you're gonna have to retire, Miz, for people to look back and be like, oh, he actually accomplished a lot. Like, do you ever feel like that people
100%. Like, I think even when anyone retires, like, you want to retire before, like, right at your popularity, right when your popularity hits like a max, and that's when people miss you the most.
Yeah.
And people will start like chanting your name and being like, yeah, we want him back. We want him back. If you just leave like randomly, like, you know, when you're just like kind of like, you know, in the middle of stuff, people are like, oh, that's okay. That's all right. So you always got to leave it on a high. Me, I will leave whenever I don't look at time. I just look at whenever it stops being fun. And honestly, I'm having the most fun I've ever had. Like, I get to be with John Morrison. I come home to my wife. I get to film Miz and Mrs. You know, I did Cannonball. We have a new production company, Mad Row Productions, that we're working on two shows, selling them right now. Like, and everything is looking really, really in the positive direction. We have a couple pitches next week about a game show idea that Maurice and I have that people are really excited
that
about.
That we actually wrote into in the playroom playing with the girls.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if you're just, if you're producing shows, I can host a game show.
Yeah, no.
What?
No. We appreciate it, but no.
I got my own studio and everything.
You might
like
snub me. You know, the first episode might come and go, Sam wants more money.
Oh, is this one of those things, like these political Hollywood things where like you make a mistake
that
and
you would pull? Yeah.
Yeah. You don't even.
You would absolutely pull.
I would pull. I feel like this is one of those things where you make a mistake against, you know, one of these power players that you don't even realize you've made. And then they spend the rest of your career just trying to get you down. I feel like
you know what you did. You know, you made the mistake. You know what you did. And it's going to take a long time for me to forgive you.
You mean the
Miz? I will tell you that you're forgiven.
Okay.
But in the back of my head, you're not.
It's not true.
It's not true. 100% not true.
I see. And even when if we have those pleasant interactions, hey, how's it going? In the back of your head, it's always like, there he is again.
He snubbed me.
There he is again.
He snubbed me for Tide Pods.
For Tide Pods. Yeah, I'm telling you, I think this is an issue with your dad where you think that people think they're better than you and that bothers you. And it's because your dad won't give you the credit that you deserve.
Well, maybe this episode of Miz and Mrs. will have helped me, you know, redeem that quality.
I hope so. Well, look, Miz and Mrs. is back. It's officially season two. By the way, why did you guys leave Texas? The season starts with you guys leaving Texas, going back to Los Angeles, which I love.
Ask my wife that.
Why did you leave Texas?
We missed L.A. We just are Californians.
We just love to move.
We love to, I miss the weather. There's so many things that I miss. I feel like, to me, L.A. is my home.
Yeah.
And then we were in Austin, and I felt like I was on a vacation somewhere. And it's just not Yeah, it's just I would get homesick, and this is weird because I'm from Montreal, so you would think, but no, I was missing LA, my friends, and just all the memories and everything. We met, we got married, we had kids, we were always in LA, and for work, it's so much easier. And Austin is a great city, but it's just not us. And then I remember we were at a party for New Year's Eve, and there's this kind of like Cirque du Soleil type of like spectacle like show, and that girl was like coming down the building attached to like a harness, and she was doing some acrobatic like, you know, stuff, and everyone was like clapping and thought I was the greatest thing, and like the greatest thing. And then Mike and I looked at each other, and right there we were like, okay, we need to move back.
that like literally New Year's was like the thing where we were like, we're gonna go out tonight, like we never go out, we never do anything, like we kind of just hang out with the kid. So we literally got home that night and we went out, we tried, and we said, oh, we're done. We need to move back to LA.
Wow.
But we can't move back in LA proper. Like, we had to find a suburb.
Yeah.
Because we got kids.
Yeah. No, that makes sense.
So we rented a house in Calabasas for 7 months until we found our house. That is hopefully the house forever.
It's my dream house. Hopefully it's yours. I mean, we literally had to redo in every single room. By the way, you know what?
What?
We have trees up right now, like Christmas trees. Maurice made me the day after Halloween go in the attic and take down 4 trees.
Do you
right
want
now,
a
we
video
have 3 trees
of
up.
All of our Christmas
it's
decorations?
Ridiculous.
I do.
You don't do Christmas until after Thanksgiving. However, at this household, we have to do it right after Halloween.
You have to see this. I just completed my last one last night.
It's annoying. It's really, really annoying, Sam.
That's insane. Here's what I keep thinking. It's like, especially since you moved into a rental and now you're moving into a permanent house. Here's why I hope it's your permanent house. I hate moving. And I can't, like, I when we moved from an apartment into a house, I was like, this is the last time that I ever want to move. And then I just watch you in horror go from, like, giant house in L.A. to a giant house in Texas to a giant house in California. This is your fourth giant house move. And when you have a giant house, you have giant houses full of stuff. Movie's the worst thing in the world.
And not only that, it's so stressful. And not only that, we have 2 little girls, which is even more stressful. So, yeah, I'm done moving.
Like, the first time Monroe was 17 days. I was packing. I was super pregnant. And then 2 weeks later, we moved in a tour bus, and we were in a tour bus for three days. The bus broke down. And that's all for real, by the way. I thought I was going to have like a panic attack.
It's so annoying when people are like, dude, that's not real. I'm like, no, that happened. That happened.
Yeah, I thought I was getting pranked. I was like, there's no way. Come on. That's not for real. Like, someone is just joking.
Our bus broke down. We had to get in a freaking like SUV. And I know it sounds like, oh, you poor you. You had a bus and everything, but we didn't fly. Like we did it because it thought it'd be a fun road trip, and it wasn't.
Also, Mocha was sick, so we couldn't really fly because she has a hydrocephalus. So we're afraid that her brain's going to, I don't know, die. So. We were, it's just a nightmare. And then I was 7 months pregnant when we moved back.
It seems like a nightmare. I hope you guys have found your permanent spot just so you don't have to go through this again. But I'll tell you right now, everybody that's listening to this, your permanent spot every Thursday night, starting this Thursday, is on the USA Network, because Ms. and Mrs. is back for a full season 2. I know I can't wait for everybody to see it, so I'm assuming that you guys are ecstatic for it.
Yeah, we can't wait. I mean, these shows are literally something that we're proud of. It shows our entire family, our dynamic, kind of who we are as people. So if you want a little insider, if you're a WWE fan, or even if you're not a WWE fan, you want a little insider of what it's like to be a WWE superstar and have a family and what it's like behind the scenes, you kind of get a taste of it and you get to laugh with your entire family. So yeah, every Thursday night on USA Network, 10:30, 9:30 Central. And it's a lot of fun. So definitely tune in.
By the way I wrapped that up, much better than the intro. Yes.
Yes. 100%.
Thank you very much.
The intro is terrible.
Thank you. All right. But we'll focus on the positive. Thank you guys. I always appreciate it.
You're the man, and you're forgiven for snubbing me.
Okay, I've heard that before, but hopefully this one sticks.
Oh, definitely.
Okay, good. Thank you.